He is a Microsoft MVP. He is a Pluralsight author and a general bag of awesome securityness. And so I think you are all as excited as I am. And I'll, without further ado, turn it over to Troy, 50 Shades of AppSec.
I'm gonna come back again with intros like that. That's awesome. Thank you. So I am from Australia, which, as most people probably know, is the other side of the world, because everything from Australia is the other side of the world. And you know, it's funny. I don't know how you guys perceive it in the US, but everyone on the other side of the world, most of what they know about America is from the TV and movies. So who here is not from the US? So like a few. So you probably have the same perceptions as me, and most of what we know about the US is sort of popular culture. So for San Francisco, I've never been here before, and I was thinking it's like Dirty Harry and Bullet, and there'd be people getting shot, and there'd be cars jumping over the thing. So I went for a walk the other day, and I didn't see any of that. And I'm not too worried about the shooting, but I would have liked to have seen the cars. I had a little rental Hyundai. Couldn't do it. Couldn't make it. But it got me thinking as well, the funny perceptions people get about other places. And I was walking my kids to school the other day on their kangaroos, and we were talking about, kangaroos don't walk. All right, let's jump into the AppSec stuff, because I do want to talk about 50 Shades of AppSec. And the thing about keynotes is they're meant to sort of be all-encompassing, right? Like, you don't get to choose to go to another session. There is the keynote, or you go and do something else. And it's hard to find a topic that resonates with everyone. So as I started to think about it more, I realized that one of the really interesting things about AppSec is that it is very diverse. There is an awful lot of stuff out there. And some of it's really cool. It's really interesting. And I thought the most interesting thing I could talk to you guys about is 50 different things, 50 different shades of AppSec. So this is what I want to talk to you about. And where I want to start is this, democratization of hacking. And what I mean by this is how easily accessible hacking is becoming to everyone. Anyone now can become a hacker. I want to give you an example of this. So did anyone see this kid last year? He's a 5-year-old kid, and he's a hacker. We know he's a hacker because the news headline tells us. But he did actually hack the Xbox. He got privilege escalation. He managed to elevate the parental controls and play Call of Duty, or whatever it was he wanted to do. He's on the Microsoft Researchers Hall of Fame now. He got a bug bounty, which is awesome. Look how excited he is. And how proud would you be as a parent if it was your 5-year-old who got a bug bounty? You know, that is awesome. Now, not only did he do that, but he managed to reproduce it, right? So Microsoft did actually have to patch the Xbox. And this is really cool, and it does go to show that anyone can become a hacker, particularly when you've got a bit of time on your hands and stubby little fingers that can't quite press the right buttons. So this is interesting, and it got me thinking about how easy it is for anyone to become a hacker. And these days, there are really easily accessible tools around. So you can go and get browser plugins like Bishop. So you put this in your browser, you browse around to all your normal sites, and it hacks for you. So it looks for misconfigured admin. It looks for unprotected source control systems. You're just browsing the web, and this thing is going away and finding the vulnerabilities for you. And then you have a look at the list and you review it, and you decide what you actually want to break into. Probably not a good idea to run this, because it is looking for things that you probably shouldn't be as you browse around real-life websites from your IP address. So that's interesting, but the other thing is that if you do actually want to learn how to become a hacker, there's a lot of information online. So there's tutorials like this. And what this one is doing is it's finding a website with a query string. They go and whack a single quote in the query string, web page loads, web page has an exception in it, which is a SQL exception. So they've found a SQL injection vulnerability. Now all they do is they go and copy the URL, and they whack it into Havage, which is a GUI-based SQL injection tool, push the button, and get all of the data out of the system. And that is literally how easy Havage is. Things like SQL Map are very powerful. This is the most awesome skiddy tool ever in order to demonstrate how simple SQL injection attacks can be. So if you want to learn how to hack, you can go and use these resources. Now, the funny thing is, when you listen to videos like this, there's a common thread across a lot of them. And that thread is that the person making the video, often their voice hasn't broken. It's very often kids. I'm going to give you an example of this later on. Kids making videos like this. And they don't understand the implications of what they're doing. But they know they can copy and paste and look at this, magic, got someone's data. Now, just in case you don't actually want to hack yourself because maybe you don't like going to jail or something like that, you can go and hire other people to do it. Hackerlist.com, hackers for hire. Now, what's interesting about this is that this is a very mainstream site. So this is not some sort of Tor hidden service and undergroundy sort of thing. This is a clear web website, and it's kind of nice. Like, it's a responsive design, it's got stock photos, lots of smiling people on there. Maybe they're the hackers or the customers, who knows? You can start a project for free. It's that easy. So hacking is now this approachable that even if you don't know how to do it yourself, you can get someone to do it for you. Now this, of course, leads into another problem, which is as hacking becomes so easy, we get these guys, hacktivists. Now, who knows what a hacktivist is? Who thinks they know? Because I'm not quite sure myself. I'm really not sure. But here is a definition I really like. This is Swift on security. If you don't know Swift on security, go and follow her or him. Many of you obviously do. But this is true, right? Like, go and find a vulnerability. There's all sorts of Google dorks that will help you easily find websites at risk. We just saw a video how easy it is to do with Havage to then find and exploit a vulnerability. We'll figure out why they deserved it later. Like, that's detailed. Don't worry about that. We'll get to that. You know, this is what happens. And a really good example of how that happens is this one here. So this is an Aussie website. And it's been hacked by Anonymous. We know that it's Anonymous because they've told us that they're Anonymous. We've got no idea who they are. But it's Op Australia and Op Trapwire and Assange, and it's Op whatever they want it to be because they will find a reason. And this one sort of says, okay, the Australian government continues to push a new blah, 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 blah. So this is an Australian government website that's been hacked, right? Except it wasn't. It's an NGO. And it is an NGO to help people with disabilities recover. It's a rehabilitation service. And these guys, and let's face it, they're going to be guys, and also let's face it, they're going to be kids, have gone and broken into the system and defaced it because they made up a reason. Well, unfortunately, it wasn't a very good reason. But that's what they're getting up to. And because anybody can become a hacker using those sort of tools that we've seen already, this sort of thing happens a lot. Now, the problem with this as well is that they are frequently kids. They're kids like this. And they're kids both in the colloquial sense of now we're all older than these guys, so everyone younger than us is a kid. And in this case, on the far right, we are literally talking about legally a child. So two guys on the left were from Lulsec. All of them here are turning up at court. At least the two on the left are. The guy on the right was waiting to go to court. I think that's since happened and it didn't work out real well for him. Now, they're turning up for court with their mums because they're still kids. That's how they get to court. Someone's got to drive them, right? They are literally children. If not in the legal sense, then very, very close to it. And it's so easy for them to become hackers, and because they're not really yet aware of the real world consequences, this is what happens. And then they get criminal records and all sorts of other things that make life very unpleasant for them. So the problem then is that once these guys become criminals, we get into this next realm of criminal hacking. And when we think about criminals, so think about criminals in the physical world. So someone wants to go and knock over a bottle shop. In Australia, if you went to knock over a bottle shop, you might get smacked with a cricket bat, something like that. In America, as I understand it, you might get shot, which is also not real good. So the sort of traditional criminal business model has got a lot of risk. Now think about that compared to the online criminal model. You could be on the other side of the world, like Australia. The thing about Australia is we get along very well with the Americans. So if anyone in Australia tries it, it doesn't work out real well for them. And some of you might see what's happening to Kim.com in New Zealand at the moment. I don't think it's going to work out real well for him because he's in a country that plays nice. However, there are plenty of other places that criminals come from, and we know some of the big suspects already. And it's very hard to track those guys down, particularly when they're small crimes. The other thing is that they can be in their bedrooms. And very often they are, because they're kids. Like, that's where they hack from. They don't go to the office, right? So criminal hacking becomes a pretty good business model. And we see a lot of really interesting things with criminal hacking. Now, one of the things I see a lot of is stuff on Pastebin. And this is an example of a paste. So for any of you that are not familiar with Pastebin, it is literally, I'm just going to copy text, put it there, it's anonymous, it's available to anyone without any authentication or authorization. You just go and view it and, you know, whatever data you want's there. Want you database off the internet, grammar not always a strong point with hacktivists, send $20 worth of Bitcoin to this address. Now this is interesting because in this case they're saying, if you pay money, we'll remove your data from the internet. And as much as we laugh at that, there are professional organizations just doing this last month with Ashley Madison. Pay us money, we'll delete your data off the internet. I'm kind of curious as to how they do that with the hundreds and thousands of torrented copies of 10 gigabytes worth of data that was dumped from them, but apparently if you pay Bitcoin, you can get it done. So in this case, they want Bitcoin and they will remove data from the internet. Now in other cases, we see pastes like this. So everyone remember when those 7 million Dropbox accounts were hacked? Not so much, no? Because this is not legitimate. This is someone will collate a whole list of data and then they'll go, and this is the Dropbox hack. And they will cobble it together from different attacks. Sometimes they probably just randomly generate the data anyway. But anyway, in this case, they're saying, if you give us more Bitcoin, more accounts will be published on Pastebin. So this is the other way around, right? The previous one was give us money, we'll take you off the internet. Now this one's give us money, we'll put more stuff on the internet. And the thing is, in these cases, they're very, very small amounts of Bitcoin too, like $20 on the previous one. And $20 is sort of the amount of money that's not too much of a barrier for most people. They go, yeah, okay, it's $20. Like, all right, maybe it's not going to come off, but my downside is $20, not too bad. So this is the thing. We see stuff like this. And interestingly, a lot of these dumps that we see have a common pattern. Now, I maintain a system called Have I Been Pwned, and I aggregate a lot of data breaches, and I make them searchable. And one of the things I aggregate is paste, so continually crawling Pastebin, looking for possible places where someone is impacted, and they might want to know that they've been exposed. And what's really interesting is I can go to paste, like those two previous ones, take an email address, and search through my system, and find that there are all these different incidents where that account appears. And if you have a look at them, you'll see the same number of emails appear in many of them. And then you'll see at one moment it's Dropbox, and then it's Facebook, and then it's Snapchat, and these have all been hacked. And all you've got to do is give Bitcoin and get more data. It's just people copying and pasting, literally copying and pasting and asking for Bitcoin. So as it turns out, you can't trust everything that you see on Pastebin. Now, there are other ways that attackers are trying to monetize what they do as well. And this was a really interesting one last year. So this clearly is a notice of extortion, and this was sent to physical businesses. This is actually a photo of a letter. You can see it's kind of folded in half. This one was sent to a pizza shop in New York. And the interesting thing here is they're saying, give us Bitcoin, there's a theme here, give us Bitcoin, or we're going to do all these things such as harassing you and making bad reviews of you online and doing all these things that we're really, really going to do unless you give us Bitcoin. It always makes me think of Pulp Fiction. Like there's this opening scene in Pulp Fiction where they're talking about a guy who goes into a bank with a telephone and he's saying, give me money or I'm going to tell the guy on the other end to kill the little girl. Now, no one knows if there's a little girl or if it's going to happen, but it's the threat and people cave to the threat. And in cases like this, it's one Bitcoin, which isn't as much these days as it used to be, but it's still a couple of $100. And you could imagine a restaurant chain going, okay, well, a couple of $100, we'll pay it. You know, make the problem go away. It's an obtainable amount of money. That got me wondering as well, what do criminals do with their money? Some of them go to Rio. And when you can own routers and modify DNS and change where a significant portion of the population's traffic goes, you can buy a lot of Rio prostitutes. Because this is what they'll do. They'll compromise the routers, update DNS, and send you to phishing pages. So if you go to a website that defaults to HTTP, which is what your browser does when you put in www without a scheme, you end up with a phishing page which says, and now please enter your credentials for whatever it was you tried to go to. And the attackers get the credentials, and then obviously there's a market for those credentials. So there's lots and lots of different ways that criminals do monetize. And one of the things that probably upsets us all is seeing criminals being successful. One of the things that probably makes us all happy is seeing criminals fail. And there's some really, really cool failures of online criminals. So this one I like. Now this is a Stack Overflow question. How can I connect to a Tor hidden service using curl in PHP? I think some people have seen this. So this question was posted by a guy called Ross Ulbricht, who is also known as the Dread Pirate Roberts, who is also known as the founder of the Silk Road underground drug market, which is no more. And he got done on a number of different things, and this was one of the things that brought him undone, where he asked a question that was very, very specific to his implementation of the Silk Road, and he had an account on Stack Overflow that was traceable to him as an individual. So one of the tips here is if you are thinking about running an underground drug market, probably don't ask questions on Stack Overflow about how to run your underground drug market. He is now spending multiple life sentences, in part for running an underground drug market, and in part for also trying to get his either competitors or people who didn't see eye to eye with him assassinated. So he's gone, partly because of questions like this on Stack Overflow. Now we also had this guy. So this guy, Jihadi John, is a guy in Syria who likes chopping people's heads off. All very nasty business. They'd capture hostages and make all sorts of demands, and then they'd execute them anyway. Now the interesting thing with Jihadi John is that he had this really strong British accent. And they know that because they always record what they're doing and post it all over the web. And the authorities are trying to figure out, why is there's this guy with this really strong British accent in Syria? Like, this is a bit of an anomaly. Now, it turns out, clearly they're paying a lot of attention to what goes on in Syria. One of the things we've all learned is the US pays a lot of attention to what's going on the internet everywhere. moving right along. So one of the things is they've discovered that someone in Syria is buying web design software in the UK from a suspicious IP address. Now, I'm going to take a guess and say there's probably not a lot of people in Syria, given the way the place is at the moment, that are buying web design software. But particularly curious was that someone was using their student ID to get a discount, their British student ID, to get a discount on the software. And it was this guy, Muhammad Anwazi. So he is Jihadi John, and all because he wanted to buy a bit of web design software. It's interesting, you sort of look at this and go, what is common between developing websites and being a terrorist chopping people's heads off? Like, I've felt suicidal after doing CSS before. Maybe it's related to that. I don't know. So he came undone. But one of my favorite ones is this, and it's not because of what you think. So this is, how do I phrase this gently? This lady was the partner of a guy who was going around and owning Texas law enforcement. Now, being from Australia, all I know about Texas is what I see on TV. And am I correct in saying Texas law enforcement probably doesn't have a big sense of humour about being owned? Fair to say? So anyway, these guys are going, okay, well, look, let's taunt them a little bit. So I imagine the way this went down is the guy doing the hacking has said to his girlfriend here, said, hey, I've got this really good idea. I'm going to print this thing out. It says, pwned by Wormer and cabin crew, love you bitches, and all of this sort of leak speak stuff. What you do is you print this out, you hold it, you get your iPhone, and you somehow balance it all together like this, and you take a photo. Now, what happens when you take a photo with your iPhone? What data gets attached to your iPhone? EXIF, geolocation down to about 7 decimal places. So they've taken this and they've posted it, and it's got the geolocation data on it. So the cops have tracked her down, and she was actually in Australia. She was down in Melbourne. And I had this funny mental picture of they've got this geolocation, they've got this photo. And I mean, it's geolocation, so it's pretty accurate, but they would have had to go around and find her. And I imagine they're sort of walking around with this photo, trying not to seem too obvious. But anyway, they track her down, and the really interesting thing is, it's this lady here. And the reason why I find this interesting is because she looks really normal. And the guy she's with looks really normal. He was Wormer and cabin crew, presumably, who are going around doing the ironing. They look like us, you know, like they look like normal people. They don't even have hoodies on, right? And they're going around doing this. And it sort of goes to that earlier point of anyone being able to be a hacker because it is so easily obtainable. And there could be those among us doing the same sort of thing. Now, I also got thinking, there's a lot of criminal activity going on, and it may well be partly our fault. We've got to admit this. It could be us as software professionals who are building bad systems. And I went looking for some examples of what might be some bad systems that we're building. Now, what can you see that might be wrong with this one? Now, take note of this, because you can Google for that text in red and find examples of this. It really does exist. And I just don't even know why you need a password in this case. The other problem you've got is if you have to reset your password, it's going to be really inconvenient. And then you can't give your phone number to your friends, right? Because that's your password, so then nobody can call you anymore. So this is maybe not such a good thing. Now, this was another one, and this was a little bit more interesting insofar as this is a betting agency, and they're particularly big in the UK. And I saw a journalist talking to the Betfair support account on Twitter saying, hey, I went to Betfair and all I needed to do to reset my password was enter my username, which is my email address, and my birth date. That's it. And then reset the password. You don't get an email. You just enter the email address and your birth date. And what's really funny about it, and the whole discussion is on my blog, I wrote a post about this, and it's just amazing to see what the Betfair account is saying, because Betfair is saying, you know, first of all, they're saying it's not possible, then they're saying you shouldn't share your username with anyone. And the journalist is going, but that's how I get email. Like, this is how people get in touch with me. And then the Betfair account saying, but you shouldn't share your birth date. And the journalist is sort of going, but I like parties, you know, like. So anyway, I did a video and I sort of went through and I went, look, like, this is crazy. Like, you can't stand out there publicly and say that, you know, either this is possible and it's not, or it's not possible and it is. And it turned out it was possible, so I recorded a piece on it and published it. And what was interesting is I showed this at AppSecEU in Amsterdam a few months ago. And after I finished the keynote, this guy came up to me and he gave me a card and it was Betfair Security. And I thought, oh shit, I'm in so much trouble. But the interesting thing was he said, thank you very much for doing this because this got the coverage that we needed in order to get it fixed. Security people know this. Most developers and any sort of software professional knows this is a bad thing, but often it is someone in marketing or it's someone who's had this bright idea that says, you shall all do this. And it's only once they get a bit of social pressure that it changes. And I kid you not, exactly the same thing happened with another example only a few weeks later. Someone at a conference came up to me and said, thank you for doing it. We got things fixed like bang, just done, after it got pressed. Now, there are other examples of doing interesting things with security. Now, just in case you can't see this down the back, let me tell you the elegance that this is. So this is JavaScript. We're declaring a username, which is admin. We're declaring a password, which coincidentally is also admin. And then there is a function to log in, or they call it check here, which makes sure that the username is equal to what was statically declared in JavaScript, and so is the password. And that is the login. Now, you laugh, but have a think about the elegance of it, right? First of all, no latency. Bang. Like, you put it in, there's no web requests straight away. That's good. It's scalable. You could have a million people logging onto the site at once. No problems. No slow hashing algorithms or things like that. People do this. Now, here's another one, and I did screen cap this myself. This is 100% legit. This is a sitemap, and it is a sitemap that has a node for every single user in the system with their email address and their password. That is real. They have since fixed that after some amount of social pressure, believe it or not. So those are kind of intriguing, but look, let's face it, they are, like, we all look at this and go, oh my God, like, how is this even possible? It should just never happen. But there are other risks that we still see that are more complex that are very prevalent. So SQL injection, good example. So this is a very typical at risk of SQL injection code example. Now, SQL injection is still number one in the OWASP top 10. It was number one in 2013, it was number one in 2010. I imagine it's probably still going to be number one next year when they do it again. And often people say to me, but like, haven't we solved this? Isn't this, like, this is a problem with legacy software, right? So this is from a tutorial about how to do a password reset in ASP.NET using the current generation of the technology that was written this year. Online tutorial, it's still there. There's a really big long comment from this Aussie guy down the bottom which says maybe you shouldn't do this, but the blog post is still there. It stands just as it is. So if people are reading this material, they're actually learning this is how you write systems. And we all know how much people like to just copy and paste in order to stand up an implementation like this. So this is really worrying because people are building systems based on this sort of advice, and we're still seeing a lot of bad advice about how to do this. Now, as much as I think we are to blame, and I sort of colloquially, collectively include all of us in this as a software industry, we also find that sometimes it's our users. Now, it's our users in that they've got a bit of fault here, but we're also making it very easy for our users to do the wrong thing. I'll give you a few examples of this. So this is Lego. This is the Lego login page, and there's a bit here that I find particularly interesting. Strong top secret password. And in a way, I can kind of get it, right? Because you're going to have a lot of kids signing up onto here, and you know, big letters and little letters are kid language. Keep it short. It's probably kid language. I guess the thing that concerns me as a parent who has kids who've got to start to learn about things like password practices is this is not really what I want them to be learning. It's not the message that we want to give them. And it's a very sort of flippant, casual, just keep it short, it'll be fine. But other times we see password advice which is really oddly specific, like from Virgin. Now, there are multiple things that worry me about this. So number one, of all the companies that is a bit worried about something that might be a little bit adult, is it like, when was the last time you saw Branson do like a press conference or a launch without bikini babes? You know? And now they're saying, we don't want wankers. So the other thing that I found very interesting about this is why don't they like wankers? And when you think about it, it's like, does the hashing algorithm get offended before it puts it in the database, you know? Does the web server get the post request and go, oh no, not wankers again? It doesn't do this. The only person that gets offended is the human that reads it. So somewhere in Virgin, humans are reading the passwords, and there's multiple other tweets and evidence that suggest that as well. So we know that there's some bad stuff going on there. And of course, we don't want to be telling users to not use certain words or not use certain characters. I saw one today from a bank justifying why you had to use a PIN for your password. It's so that they didn't have XSS problems. True story, I retweeted this morning, and it's unfathomable. From a bank. So that's rather concerning. And when it comes to the security messages that we're giving people, sometimes we have some really interesting messages. So for example, security questions. Now who can see what's wrong here? And the funny thing is, as bad as that Capital California question is, and let's face it, that's not a security question, that's a pub trivia question. The other ones really aren't much better, and we've totally glossed over them. Things like favorite colors, red, green, blue, there's about 60% of your answers. You know, and the rest are kind of, all right, a little bit obscure. So this is concerning. Now, security questions are obviously something that still remain popular. Some people vehemently disagree with how effective they actually are. But there's something that we still use, and you see websites trying to get very creative about how they create good security questions, because it can be a hard problem. And sometimes they get very, very specific about their questions. I'm guessing that wasn't the name of the dog, I'm just saying. Can you imagine your grandmother calling the dog? I won't do it, but yeah, you can imagine. And it's just obscure, like how, if an end, and this is sort of the point of this section, right, that the end users are getting such odd messages that are setting them up for failure. If they see this, like what are they going to do? I wouldn't even know how to answer. Actually, the way I would answer it is I would just create a random string in one password, and that would be the name of the dog, and then you'd never be able to call the dog. But that would be in the system. So we give really, really odd kind of advice and questions to end users. And you know, that got me thinking, if we keep doing this, and obviously there are lots of crazy examples like this, is it maybe a problem with us as the developers? So are we actually possibly teaching developers the wrong things? And it's interesting when you go online and you look at the tutorials that teach you things about technology. And I found a really good one that has something to say about how to use some tools you guys might be familiar with. So I'm going to play this one.
Hey, what's up, YouTube? This is NextGen Hacker 101, and today I'll be teaching you guys how to view other computers' IP addresses. All right, what you do is you type in tracer T, and then space. All right, now this is a cool thing. Tracer T and then space. Now what you want to do is you want to type the site you want to view. So you want to go HTTP, semicolon, slash slash, and then, well, not semicolon, the little dot dot, and then the website. So, like, let's just say Google. Oops. So, like, let's just say we want to see how many IPs are looking at Google right now. And, like, at this exact moment, we're going to find how many people are looking at Google, what their IPs are, and what their connection speed is. Here we go. Once you've done, tracer T, space, and then the website, HTTP, dot dot, slash slash, and the website, I'm doing Google. You want to go ahead and do that as an example. And then you enter it. And here we go. Here they come. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And hold it. Hold it. All right. 10 people are currently using Google and looking at it.
This is why we need parental supervision on the internet. But look, like, good on the kid for having a go. And if you listen to this, okay, clearly it is a kid and you know not to take it too seriously, unless it was the very early days of Google, I don't know. But you can sort of make a judgment decision on your confidence in who is teaching you the lessons about security. Now, what is harder is when you look around further and you see some of the other lessons that people get taught about security. So we just saw the SQL injection one as an example. I found another one here from a professional learning site. It wants you to store a credit card and it wants you to use a base 64 encryption function to store the credit card. Now, who knows what's wrong with base 64 encryption? Base 64 decryption is somewhat of a problem. But this is legitimate. This is a learning site that people paid access for. And this is what people were taught. And I guarantee you there are credit cards encrypted with, okay, let's stop it, stored with base 64. Our credit cards are in those systems. And of course we can't see that from the outside, we can speculate about it when they get owned, but this sort of stuff does happen because there are professional learning services out there that do sometimes give this sort of advice. Now it's interesting looking at the sort of advice that developers get online, and I went looking at Stack Overflow and I found a really good one here. And the question here was, I'm building a system, I want to know how to store my passwords. Now, this is in C#, so let me just sort of run through this for those of you that are not familiar. So they've got an input string, it's HAI. Just an example, imagine that's your password. Now, what the guy's going to do is he says, let's do a for each, and we take each character, and what we do is we get the ASCII value. And we increment the ASCII value by 5. And that turns HAI into, and let me just make sure we read this out. Now the output contains the encrypted string, MFN. Now guess how you decrypt it? You go through one by one and then you subtract 5. And this was a legitimate Stack Overflow question, but there are two other questions, or rather two other answers as well, which are also quite good. So one of them said you should use Base64, what do we call it? Encryption. But the other one was really cool, because what the guy said, he said, no, like, don't do this. Don't do the ASCII thing with the 5. What you do is you get the ASCII value for each character, and you add 13. And then guess how you decrypt it? You go back the other way. Now, what really struck me with this, and I have all of these on my blog as well. I did capture them before they were voted down and eventually voted off. What struck me is how quickly these answers came up after the question was asked. Now, how could you get all of that code up there minutes after the question was asked? How did these guys do this? Because they've gone, I know, I built this system the other day in production. I'm just going to go and copy this, and I'm going to paste it, and there's your answer. So just as with the Base64 encryption of the credit cards, we have ASCII offset encryption. Is that a fair way of putting it? Encryption of passwords. And we all have passwords being stored this way in systems. We don't know where they all are. We can probably speculate on some of them, but this is what is happening. Now, it's really interesting to see the sorts of questions that developers or other technology professionals are asking about security. Who uses this bank? Jeez, I hope it's not mine, really. And, you know, maybe this was even someone just mucking around, right? Having a bit of a joke. But the problem is, it is just believable enough that we all go, yes, it's hilarious, but I could imagine someone actually doing it. Because we do see things that are absolutely nuts. And sometimes it includes stuff like this. Now, I also don't want to just beat up on the developers, because I've got a development background, and I don't think it's all just us to blame, because sometimes it is the security guys as well. Now, there's a really good server fault question, which is about our security auditor. And I want to just point out a couple of the bullet points here. Basically, the security auditor is saying, I need from you the plain text password of every user in your system. And then, but wait, there's more. Every time you change the password, every time the user changes the password, I want to get an email with that password. Now, and again, this is up on server fault. You can Google this, you can find it. After this, the guy explains that the security auditor starts berating him for not being able to do it. He's like, any developer worth their salt can get all the plain text passwords out and give them to me. And this is the security auditor. And you can see it's got quite a lot of votes. Apparently people quite liked this one. So I can understand that it can be difficult for security professionals. And you know, look, I look at something like cryptography and it blows my head when I look at it. It really does. It is a really confusing, complex thing. And it's understandable that sometimes people wouldn't say understand the difference between Wingdings and PGP. They all look like little aeroplanes and buildings. Like isn't that what encryption is? Turning it into smiley faces? It is a complex thing, and it can be very confusing. I get that. But I guess one of the places this leads us as well is that we shouldn't be taking all the blame. It's not all our fault as developers and as security professionals. And we do have to take a little bit of time to blame our users from time to time. Now, a really good example is this one here. Now, whose Twitter account is this? I'll give you a hint, it's not McDonald's. Even though it says verified, so it turns out having verified next to the logo and next to the text doesn't actually mean it's them, because in this case, it's Burger King. And this was a few years ago, and Burger King got owned by someone. Twitter was actually hacked. Everyone remember when Twitter got hacked? So Twitter was hacked, and someone broke in and started saying detrimental things about the Whopper and ranting on about McDonald's. And one of the interesting things about this is Burger King had like 90,000 followers. So I think this was in about 2012. Had about 90,000 followers. This happened, and then the next day they went all the way up to 120,000. They got 30,000 followers overnight. So if anyone's looking for like a social campaign, you know, maybe this sort of stuff seems to have actually worked quite well for them. But of course, Twitter didn't get hacked. And this probably drives you guys as nuts as it drives me when we see it in the news. Facebook's hacked, Twitter's hacked. And inevitably what's happened is someone has made a very bad password choice, or they've had it disclosed or reused or something like this. It almost always boils down to the end user. And you may be wondering, how do our end users keep disclosing their credentials? Because we see this a lot. We saw Tesla just a few months ago. Same thing happened to Tesla. And just being verified doesn't stop this from happening. So we got a good lesson actually just a few months ago. This is TV5 Monde in France. And TV5 Monde got their Twitter account owned. Twitter got hacked again. So this guy is on the news explaining what happened, and the cameras are filming him, and he's sitting here in his seat, probably in his office, with some things behind him that may be social media passwords, broadcast on the national news. And you look at this, and like, we all know what is wrong with this. And I'm sure that after it happened, TV5 Monde probably felt very embarrassed about it, and they actually came on the news again the next day. They had another story about it, and they had this guy on. And there may have been a little problem at the time. So sometimes it is our users, and I guess on a more serious note, clearly in cases like this as well, they're missing things like two-step verification. So they are missing the security controls that we have available, but they're also using these other pretty ordinary practices. But I do think that we also set users up to fail many times. And again, I say we collectively as an industry. So we look at apps like this. So this is a QR barcode scanner for Android. Now look at what your QR code barcode scanner needs in order to run. It needs the calendar. It needs the contacts. It's like the scanner needs to find a time in your diary that is appropriate to scan the QR code. But here's the problem. From an end user perspective, if they go and get this app, what do you think the one thing is they see on the screen? Right, it's like, what is the thing that is between me and getting done what I want to do? It's the accept button. So users are going to click through just like none of us ever read terms and conditions except for that one time when we're just really curious. You know, we just don't do it. We just accept it and move on. But one of us, and again, collectively as an industry, one of us built this system that said it needs access to all this. And there's a whole bunch of people that would have said accept and give the app access to all their contacts and all their calendars, which is just nuts. So we condition people to have these really bad behaviors. And we give them very confusing, inaccurate information about security. So for example, imagine you went to buy an HDMI cable. Now, when was the last time you bought one with antivirus protection? I'm sure it's the same here, but there is a lot of FUD about HDMI cables in Australia. Pretty sure it's the same all around the world. But the problem is, like, imagine your non-technical parents or children or significant others going to the store and they've got two cables. They're, you know, they want to buy a cable, and they're like, well, this one's got antivirus protection. Like, what are they going to do? So someone is putting these messages out there which are clearly just ridiculous. Can we really blame consumers for not necessarily knowing the difference? It's a confusing thing. So we have a messaging problem. We're often telling people things that are very incorrect. Now, the worst offenders of this are social channels, and I'm sure we all see this on Twitter and Facebook. We see social accounts, inevitably someone just there at a desk responsible for responding to people, giving security advice. And we learn some really interesting things when we look at the advice that they're giving people. So for example, this guy doesn't like having a 12-character limit on his password, which seems quite reasonable to me. Now, Staples actually makes it very clear why the limit is there. Because security. I mean, how do you even argue with that? You know, like, where do we go from here? And this is often all it is. It's just a yoink, no, we can't, this is why, and it doesn't make any sense whatsoever. Now, I want to show you another one, and the background on this is that someone said to British Gas, I want to use a password manager, and I actually want to paste my password into the field. So, you know, he's doing a good thing by having a strong password that he needs a good password manager to use, and here's what British Gas said to him. Now, I am enormously curious about this, because first of all, I wonder what security certificate it is that they're worried about losing. It's like their PCI compliance, their SSL certificate, who knows? But I really like the bit about the brute force attack, because you've got to think about this, right? The guy is wanting to paste a password, and British Gas here is going, okay, but this could brute force. And I got this picture of like a Chinese sweatshop, right? And there's just all these people, control C, control V, control C, control V. And that's about as close as I can get to it, because it makes absolutely no sense whatsoever. But there it is. It's out on Twitter. Now, we're also seeing cases where people are being encouraged to use very bad practices. So, for example, EE asking for very sensitive, personally identifiable information via DM. Now, the problems with this are numerous. One of them, of course, is that somewhere this is just going to sit in plain text. On the user's Twitter feed, possibly on the EE end. Could also be just emailed to EE. Who knows how they've got their Twitter configured? You can get your DMs emailed to you. The other thing that worries me is how easy would it be for any of us here to set up a Twitter account, call it at EE help, support, love, whatever you want it to be, and just start replying to people who ask a question mentioning EE. You get the right logo. You wouldn't have the verified logo. Someone like Mike would probably shut you down pretty quick, but you might get a few. Like, you'd just respond and you'd say, oh, please send me your details. And you would get people sending you details because they're being conditioned for a very, very bad practice. So this is worrying, and you see this happen with a number of different companies. Now, one other one, and this one actually came back to me, and I'm still trying to figure this out. See if you can work out what they're saying. This was about 3 years ago. I'm still thinking about it. I still don't quite get what actually happened. So that was interesting, and unsurprisingly, they did have a major security incident sometime after that as well. But yeah, you just wonder about social accounts. So yeah, tip for any social media people, when security people start asking questions, take it offline. Do not have these discussions in public. Now, I thought I'd talk about something else because it's a little bit hard not to talk about this in the current climate and based on what I was doing last month, which is actually medicine. And this is a really interesting event for many, many different reasons. So first of all, for those of you who are not familiar with Ashley Madison, their whole modus operandi was to have affairs. Their slogan here is life is short, have an affair. So this is what they were there to do. Now, I snapped this before all the data got leaked. And you can see that there are discrete encounters, trusted security award, 100% discrete, SSL secure site. There are a lot of really shiny bitmaps on that site. Now, who knows what it looks like now? Exactly the same. Exactly the same. It's like they're just sticking their fingers in there going, la, 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 like if we just, you know, keep doing this, it'll go away. But of course it won't. And the reality of it is that 37 million accounts, of which there are about 30 million unique email addresses, which in itself says something, were compromised, were disclosed. And this is really interesting for a number of reasons. So, you know, one of them is that we're increasingly seeing InfoSec get mainstream media. So I did a lot of talks to media that, like, my parents would watch or friends who are non-technical because it impacts so many people just beyond the technology community. That was one interesting thing. Another interesting thing that comes to mind is that after this happened, one of the very few media releases they made talked about the credit cards. And basically what they're saying is, okay, so we got owned, we had a really big problem, your wife is gonna leave you, you'll never see your kids again, but good news, your credit cards are okay. And this is what often happens. Websites get compromised, and then the site owners come out and they have an announcement, and they say, you know, good news, credit cards are okay. Now, pro tip, this is not for the users. This is for the banks and the merchants. They wanna keep PCI happy. And in fact, it's funny, I wrote about this a few weeks ago. I said, you know, look, it's never, you know, I'm never really worried about my credit card because if it gets owned, it'll just get replaced. And I don't know if someone read that and took issue with it or if it was just coincidental, but literally a few days after my wife's credit card got owned. But here's the thing. We noticed fraudulent transactions on a Monday morning. I went to the bank. By the end of the day, the money was back in the account. By the end of the week, there's a new card in the mailbox. I don't want my credit card to be defrauded, but it doesn't worry me near as much as telling the world that I was having an extramarital affair. And this was really the problem here. Now, the other big problem that came up from this is stuff like this. Now, this is an Ashley Madison search site. A lot of sites popped up very quickly that allowed anybody to search for any attribute of anybody by any attribute. So what we're seeing here is someone has searched for a person who was in Ashley Madison, and it's coming back and it's giving you information about them, including things like birth date, which is very sensitive personal information. A lot of these sites popped up, and they popped up very quickly. Now, one of the things I had to do very early on, because I have this Have I Been Pwned system where I load data in there and I make data searchable so that people can figure out what their risk is, and I made the decision very early on that this is too volatile. I can't make this available for anyone to search by. So I made people verify themselves. If you can prove that you own an email address, I'll give you a yes or no answer as to whether or not the email address was in there. And in retrospect, that seems to have been a good decision because a bunch of these guys are now getting sued as well. But there were a lot of these sites that popped up very quickly and obviously very hastily cobbled together. And you might be wondering, why would these sites do this? Like, what is the upside to create this sort of service? And it makes more sense when you put this image in context. Look at all those ads. So the top one, is he cheating on you? Often I saw this rotate through with divorce lawyers, so very contextual advertising, I'll give them that much. We got three other ads down the right-hand side. Everything beneath that image is also an ad. Some of them link through to mSpy, which was also compromised this year, with all sorts of email addresses leaked, not only of the people doing the spying with effectively what is their malware installed on victims' devices, but also the victims' identities. So it almost makes your head spin, because now we've got this big Ashley Madison site which has been compromised, where you can search for other people, and then it will also tell you to get the spyware, which was also compromised. And it's this nasty kind of loop. I got emails from people. In fact, I got thousands of emails, because I wrote quite a bit about it, and people sort of vented a little bit. And I'll give you an example of that in a moment. But lots of emails from people with examples of things like, I got a call from our church who found my husband on one of these services. What? Like, who is doing this? Another person said, we've got a community bulletin board system and people are posting up the names of everyone in our neighborhood who was in Ashley Madison. And the problem is, it wasn't just people having affairs either. So you had single people. You had people who had lost partners and moved on. You had people that were on there at a time of life that is very different to now. I had multiple emails of women who thought their husbands were cheating on them, went and signed up, caught them, got divorced, like massive disaster in their life, and now they're being fingered as an adulterer because they're being found in these searches. So it's like a double whammy. And I think people lose sight of that. But these sort of search services were promoted quite a bit. We saw things like this. So this was a service where you could search for anyone. And not only could you search for anyone, but in this case, you were encouraged to tweet that you had searched for people like your friend. And then encourage other people to go and search for their friends. So they were actually propagating this idea of invading privacy by searching for whoever you felt like searching for. But I've got one more thing on here, and I think this should hopefully put into context just what this incident meant to some people. And for those of you in the back who's maybe a little bit small, let me read it. This guy has a number of things to say, but at the end he says, I'm on edge, Troy. I've contemplated suicide daily for the past week. My two beautiful children and my wife are keeping me alive. And he goes on to say how he doesn't know how long he'll have them for. And I think the thing that's really interesting here is that we very often don't think about the human impact of the systems we build. We think about traditional attackers and identity theft and all this sort of thing, but we miss these sort of real-world human impact stories. And I know for me, after sort of seeing this, the things that I build and get involved in the future, I'll have a different perspective in terms of what it might mean if something goes really, really badly wrong. So I just think that's something worthwhile thinking about as you guys build and secure systems in the future. But I don't want to talk about one more thing, and this is a lot more lighthearted than Ashley Madison. And it's the impact of the physical world on digital security. Now, I'll give you an example of this. I've got a really good image. It's this one. Now, I like this, you know, because this is just the most basic example of how our things in the physical world can circumvent digital security. And I would imagine that something like this was never really in the threat model, you know. Password could be printed and put in an envelope with a window on it. Paper may be slightly smaller than envelope and you could jiggle it around and find the password. So physical security can be really, really good at circumventing digital security. You can do things like this. Now for those who may not know what this is, these are RSA tokens. They're used for two-factor authentication. You have a PIN with your RSA token which has been very conveniently written above each token. There is a webcam shining at the tokens, broadcasting it somewhere so that this whole idea of two-factor being something you have now means what you need to have is internet access, because then you can access the webcam. Now, fortunately, webcams never do get exposed publicly, which is good news. But this sort of thing does happen. Now, in a way, this is kind of trivial, But one of the other things we've seen, particularly this year, is less trivial connected things. So Chris was in the news quite a bit a few months ago. And as you can see here, he did actually hijack the plane midair. Apparently you can hijack a plane by plugging in a cable. But by the same token, who would actually want to be on a plane with this guy as he's plugging stuff in under the seat, seeing if he can make the plane fly sideways? Allegedly, he made the plane fly sideways. I would love to see someone give him a plane. I think that would be really curious. I would not want to be sitting next to him. But it was funny the way the press covered it too, because they said, on the one hand, he made the plane fly sideways, and apparently he also hacked the International Space Station. So if he did do those things, maybe it's more NASA than it is NSA. I don't know. But it's curious how this sort of physical world and digital technology interacts when we talk about security. And of course, one of the big things we're talking about a lot lately is IoT. So everyone is very excited about IoT. Developers are excited about building it. Security people are excited about breaking it. So we see lots and lots of cases of vulnerabilities being found in IoT. Now this is Lifx, and it's an Aussie brand, so on the one hand I want to be kind of supportive to it. On the other hand, they did have a rather interesting vulnerability. Now, keep in mind this is a light bulb, right? And people would put the light bulb in their house, and it would be connected, and you'd have this companion app, and you could sort of change the colors and, you know, control room by room. I like the idea. I'd like to have some of these, if they weren't like $100 each. So they're a nice idea. But they did have a security vulnerability. And the curious thing is, when people think about IoT having a vulnerability, they think about the device itself. And people would say, well, would I really be that upset if an attacker put my bedroom into disco mode? You know, like, I don't want them to put it into disco mode, but if that's the worst that can happen, do I care? Now, here's what's really interesting. The vulnerability with Lifx didn't just give the attacker control of the light bulbs. It gave them the credentials of the Wi-Fi network they're on. So here's where we're going with IoT. It's not just about the device, it's about the risk to the ecosystem. And we often don't think about that. Now, Lifx did acknowledge they had a problem, and they told everyone that they should patch their light bulbs. I just have no idea. Like, I imagine that they don't have USB ports. Maybe it's Bluetooth. Maybe you do it with the companion app. Maybe it's easy. Evidently, they weren't self-updating if they're telling everyone that they've got to patch the light bulbs. There's probably an observation there about IoT security. So they said, okay, go and patch your light bulbs, which everyone apparently did. And then they said, but don't worry, we haven't had any reports of anyone being owned by their light bulbs. And I thought that was particularly curious because think about the attack, right? It was disclosing the Wi-Fi credentials. Now, if you discovered that your neighbor was leeching off your Wi-Fi, would you go, oh, better so those bloody light bulbs I put in the other day? We're not quite ready to have that discussion. I don't think we've accepted just how connected our things are getting. And I really don't think we've accepted this sort of connectivity. Who's got one of these? This is Pluralsight. It's a Japanese toilet. And this is the companion app. I want to talk you through what we're seeing here. And I can only speculate because it's all in Japanese. So the first one, the top left one, is some sort of a splash screen. The middle one is like it's a calendar, right? I get that. And there's some sort of event-driven data on the calendar. But I love the front one. I kid you not, I did not make this up. You can Google it and find the image. It's obviously an MP3 player, and the toilet is playing I Can't Get No Satisfaction. But here's the thing. I talked about this a couple of years ago, and I said this is going to be really interesting when this actually has a vulnerability, because this is going to be like a new frontier for security. And wouldn't you know it, they did. This is a TrustWave advisory. That is horrifying. I showed this at a talk once, and someone said, yeah, that's a backdoor attack. And on that note, thank you very much. So I think we have a bit of time for questions. I may not be able to answer toilet-related questions, but if there are other questions, anyone want to ask anything while we're here? Yeah, Jim.
Any hope for anything even remotely positive, Troy?
Is there any hope for anything? Yeah, right, related to security. I think there are some positive things. Like, I really like the idea of the light globes, and maybe not the toilet. It doesn't appeal to me. But, you know, I think these things can obviously be hardened a lot better. I'll give you a really good example. One of the things that worries me about LIFX is they had to tell people to go out and patch their light bulbs. And that worries me when you have to take an action in order to harden your things. So, for example, who actually updates their router software? Like, three, four? Barely anyone. Like, it's hard. You've got to go and do it manually. I've got some of those Withings scales that are kind of neat. They're connected scales. You stand on them, they take your weight, and it puts it to an API, and you can track over time. And the other day, I stood on my scales, and the scales had a new feature. And this sounds weird, but it did. It actually told me the weather, because it's got this little LCD display. And that's actually really useful. Like, you get out of the shower first thing in the morning, you stand on the scales, and here's what the weather's going to be before you get dressed. So the scales were able to auto-update. And I would imagine that if my scales had a vulnerability where my Wi-Fi could get owned, they would be able to remote update over the air. So I think that there is light in that sort of thing, and hopefully that will be one of the sort of IoT patterns that we see become more prevalent. All right, anyone else? Everyone's still thinking about the toilet. All right, well, that was easy. thank you, Jim. Oh, yeah, here's one.
How do you feel about the other websites getting sued? Do you think it should be illegal to publish that type of data?
So how do I feel about the other websites being sued? The other Ashley Madison websites being sued? Look, kind of mixed emotions in that, in the one hand, I think that what they did was definitely wrong. I mean, obviously, I think it was because I really consciously elected not to do that. On the other hand, I worry a little bit that sometimes these incidents just become opportunities for litigation. And you saw within 1 week, there was about $500 million worth of class actions already against Ashley Madison. And I think they deserve to have the book thrown at them, but I think it often becomes an opportunity for people to try and cash in. And for the sites doing this, you know, look, the people should have got a slap over the wrist. And I, even just this morning, I was reading one person has reached a settlement already with three plaintiffs, apparently. So they deserve to cop something. I'm not sure that it should be serious litigation that sort of affects them for the rest of their life, though. Yeah?
Did you ever felt the same for certain threats? If there's a business need in our corporation, for example, and they come and say, we want to do that, what do you think from a security perspective? And from a security perspective, they build it correctly, but from a privacy perspective, it's a horrible thing. What should we be saying?
So from a privacy perspective, we're worried because it's sensitive data, but if they build it correctly from a security perspective, how do we feel about it? So you're talking about Facebook? But hey, look, maybe Facebook is a good example, and I mean, I use Facebook like many other people, and I guess that the challenge is that they're meeting a need, right? Like, people want this sort of data, they want to share this sort of data, and organisations like Facebook do a tremendous job of doing really innovative things with security. We hope we don't see them turn into an Ashley Madison, but I almost think that the question is more for the end users in terms of what is the assumption that you should work to when you use these services. So, you know, assuming that, you know, Alex and co do the best possible job they can at securing things, I think that they have a good chance of fending off, you know, pretty much everything of significance. And I am more interested in what we tell consumers. For example, maybe don't put nudie pics on Facebook, because who knows what might happen to them after that. Yeah?
I find myself in a catch-22 sometimes when I'm trying to educate my family and friends about security and trying to get more common sense things that might be easy, but and maybe more families, friends, and groups better if they do this, but I find with it that once all my family and friends know that I'm an information security person, they'll say, well, you'll just protect me, right? How do you deal with that? How do you approach your friends and family and try and get them on board for real?
Right, so Ryan's saying that the problem is it's like you become the IT support guy. It's like if you're the guy with the pickup, you're the one who's always called to move people's furniture, right? I'll tell you exactly what I did, because my mother-in-law recently needed a new computer. And I was worried because she was always messing up her PC. So I got her an iPad. Problem almost completely solved. Because it is sandboxed. You can only take stuff from the App Store. There's not an awful lot you can do with it. They've been really resilient against attacks. I think, honestly, one of the best things I've done is just get her a device that is really hard for her to screw up and not give her the Wi-Fi password so she can't give it to her friends or anything like that. It's like, you are locked down, that's all. And worst case, if you lose the iPad or you blow it up or whatever, we'll just restore from iCloud and we'll move on. So I think it's actually easier than ever to not be the support guy by just getting it right in the first place.
Great. All right. I want to take this moment again and say thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, Matt.
Very good.